And welcome to today's Talks at GS session with Amory Lovins. He's a physicist, environmental scientist, an energy expert, and an author of more than 25 books. And Steve Strongham will be moderating the conversation. He is the head of global investment research and also an energy expert in his own right. So it's a great pleasure to welcome Amory Lovins.
Welcome, Amory. It's a pleasure to have you here.
Good to be here.
As someone who also occasionally writes, I have to admit to a certain envy for the title of the book, Reinventing Fire. It has to be one of the great titles I have ever seen. How did you take that direction? What brought about sort of that view of the world?
Well, I'd been noodling about energy for a long time as the master key to the tangled problems of economy, security, development, health. Gradually, we did a lot of work, probably the most detailed in the world, on how to save electricity, and worked in equal depth in all the energy-using sectors, transport, building, industry, electricity, and watched the renewable revolution take off, sputter, lie dormant for a while, take off again, get into the nice spiral of ever cheaper, so we buy more, so it gets cheaper, so we buy more. And now it's, efficiency and renewables and cogeneration are over a $600 billion a year enterprise in the world and growing nicely. But in Reinventing Fire, we attempted a very ambitious synthesis of American energy solutions, and now we've done a similar exercise for China that'll be out in 2 months with our Chinese partners. And the big poetic title just comes from the history that very long ago, fire made us human, then fossil fuels made us modern, but now we need a new fire that makes us safe, secure, healthy, and durable. That turns out to be feasible. It actually works better and costs less than what we are doing.
When you look at the future that way, renewables, slightly different definitions for different people on occasion. What do you think it looks like in 20 years? What percent, which are the renewables that are actually the world?
Well, it's a diverse portfolio of them, dominated by photovoltaics and wind. But let me jump ahead a little more than 20 years, because we actually aimed at 2050 and showed that by then the U.S., for example, could be running a 2.6-fold bigger economy with no oil, no coal, no nuclear energy, a third less natural gas, tripled efficiency, quintupled renewables, so the electric system would be 80% renewable, half distributed, highly resilient. The total energy system would be about three-quarter renewable. The net present valued cost of all that, if externalities are worth zero, a conservatively low estimate, turned out to be about $5 trillion cheaper than business as usual. And this would require no new inventions, no act of Congress, because the policy innovations needed could all be done by federal administrative decision and at a state level, where we make most of our energy policy anyway. So the transition we had in mind is led by business for profit.
Who are the big winners and losers within the renewables? Right, you started off with solar and wind. Do you think those two are the vast bulk of that, or are there some others that play a role?
Probably, and I think it's clear that photovoltaics are beating solar thermal electric, although it will have some niche markets, and probably a lot of the solar thermal technology will head towards process heat and cogeneration over time. Biofuels, the current ones, currently in volume ones, are not very interesting, mainly because of the bad way we grow the feedstocks. But there are some advanced ones that are quite interesting, and we ended up with a total U.S. Mobility fuel market of about 3 million barrels a day, which you can make two-thirds from waste, not need cropland, and not harm soil or climate. And those technologies are just in pilot or scale-up right now, and looking pretty good. They're actually in the Navy's operational procurement this year. Of course, if you really dig into biofuels, you quickly discover that we need biologically informed agriculture and forestry that don't treat soil like dirt. That's a separate, much bigger question. So the notion that that the variability of photovoltaics and wind is a serious limit on renewable deployment is turning out not to hold up either empirically or analytically, even though it's still a fairly widespread view. We are also finding rapid learning in batteries, which are not easy, but their technology is driven by consumer electronics. Their volume is driven by electric cars. The combination is very potent and is starting to allow people, as many are doing in Hawaii, to drop off the grid altogether. So it leaves the old utility business models no place to hide. We got 21st century technology and speed colliding head on with 20th and 19th century institutions, rules, and cultures. And it's you know, electricity is the most disruptive place to be right now. Basically, what's happening in electricity is the customers are figuring out they can and should buy fewer electrons, more productivity in using them, and maybe make some of their own. It's a good idea to sell customers what they want before someone else does. All the rest is detail, but it's a lot of interesting and exciting detail in how can the incumbents thrive in the new world, and is their culture ready for that kind of change?
It's interesting you bring up culture change, because a lot of the numbers you just cited have to do with changes in demand patterns, right? You know, consuming more electricity at night, consuming less during the day, things of that sort. How do you see that revolution occurring? How is it you actually get people to change? I mean, we have a fair amount of experience. Some societies seem to do that easily and quickly. In the U.S., we've always observed this phenomena that people in their cars seem to be more of a religion than a mode of transportation at times.
Cars are a vehicle for more than bodies, yeah. They're a vehicle for emotions.
So how is it you get the culture change to get people to actually consume according to the conductor as opposed to their own personal randomness?
So I think real-time pricing, and at least as an approximation, time of use pricing, is obvious. We don't have prices that tell the truth. Locational pricing is harder politically, but actually there are ways to do it that are fair. Like you charge everybody the same in your service territory for a kilowatt hour, no matter where you are, but then you publish a map showing the hot spots of congested distribution where you're about to have to do something expensive to a substation or feeder to expand or modernize. And you offer a premium according to what it's worth to you for people to do demand management efficiency or distributed generation in that area to knock down your peak cost. Because otherwise, there are kilowatt hours on a hot afternoon that cost you dollars to deliver and you'd sell them for a dime. And you can't just keep doing that and make it up on volume. The modern art and science of demand response, used to be called load management, about when people use electricity, is usually an IT mashup that gets invisible to the customer. So if we were to turn off your air conditioner for 15 minutes, you would never know.
Actually, that's sort of the perfect segue to the question. You know, you make a very detailed and compelling case for sort of the underlying numbers. But when you look at consumer behavior, I'm mindful of two particular things. The automakers and the struggles they have had to get people to buy fuel-efficient cars, the issues around CAFE, that people keep buying trucks as opposed to things that weigh a third the amount. And even more interestingly, some of the local utilities essentially giving away LED light bulbs because it would save them so much on the demand side and somehow not getting people to take them. How is it you engage people to actually want the efficiencies that are achievable? Because they don't seem to have quite the level of consumer interest that the broader efficiencies would.
This is where it gets to be interesting and fun. I had not heard of bad uptake on LEDs, but there are some that if you gave me, I wouldn't want because they're a lousy product. On the other hand, there are some terrific ones that are just plug-in replacements. And for what it's worth, white LEDs, which are now gorgeous. I mean, my wife's a fine art landscape photographer. We use them to light her art in my house. And she is now doing with 12 watts what she used to do with 500 in her gallery. But If you have good quality LEDs, you might like to know that every decade they are getting 30 times more efficient, 20 times brighter, and 10 times cheaper. So I think that problem is going to solve itself.
So first, I'm on your side. Our house is all LEDs. Okay.
Thank you.
So before I head that direction.
So right. you are part of the solution because U.S. electric demand has been falling since 2007, and you own a piece of that. Thank you.
That's right. But I'm more struck by the fact that on the website where we bought them is ads for the old incandescents, right, so that people can get them, you know, manufactured, moved from Bolivia, I'm not quite sure where, so that people can still get their old incandescent bulbs.
Good Lord. Right.
It's sort of an amazing thing, right? How do you get that turn? What's the psychological thing that'll help us get there? Or is it the government's actually just going to force it at some point?
I think government should steer, not row, but I didn't know there was that much of a black market in incandescent lamps.
I'm pretty sure you don't listen to right-wing radio stations, but I got to tell you, the war against incandescent bulbs is one of their topics.
Yeah, I was aware of that. There's a more basic question here. Let me take you back to a little history. Edison invented the incandescent lamp, solving the problems that 13 previous inventors had not quite got through. In 1879, in the next 3 years, he rolled out generators and power stations and utilities and stuff like that. And he didn't sell electricity. He sold lighting service. He would charge you a penny to run a light bulb for an hour. He probably did not anticipate that his incandescents would ultimately become so antique they'd get outlawed. But he did know as an inventor that lamps were going to get a lot more efficient. So when New York Edison Company wanted to sell to lights and motors and other stuff that was coming in and meters were invented, he said, look, if we do that, more efficient lamps will reduce our revenue, not our cost of providing the lighting service. But they overruled him in 1892. And other than street lighting, where his business model survives, we've been making the same mistake ever since of having the wrong business model, where customer efficiency cuts the provider's revenue, not the provider's cost. And the fuel industry's made exactly the same mistake, selling volume of fuel rather than the service you want it for, like mobility. Well, look at what's happening now, which is going to be deeply disruptive to auto and electricity companies and automakers, where the sharing economy, the IT energy mashup, is really getting nicely mature.
So that's a perfect sort of wedge on the economics split, because I think we look at the sharing economy as this incredible innovation that certainly does radically change capacity utilization, and the economics of that seems very straightforward. On the other hand, when you look at the limo services in New York City, the hybrid ones are having problems, right? In other words, for whatever reason, when people go in, they tend to like these tanks, right? And in fact, the high-end stuff actually tends to be the bigger cars. The efficient car, on the other hand, seems to be tougher to get people to.
Well,
I've run into a prop.
Okay.
Go for it.
So I brought my carbon cap. This is a little test piece for military helmets that have been shipping for some years using a process we cooked up that made this thing in 1 minute 8 years ago. And you can tell from the sound it's extremely strong and stiff, tougher than titanium. Tom Friedman whacked it with a sledgehammer and couldn't even scuff it. And what is this about? Well, we came up with this because two-thirds of the energy it takes to move a car is caused by its weight. And every unit of energy you save at the wheels by taking out weight or drag saves 7 units of fuel, because you don't need to waste 6 more units along the way getting the energy to the wheels. So if you take the obesity out of the car and make it out of really light, strong materials and make it a fit design, so it's lithe, lean, slippery, light, it takes about 3 times less energy to run it. If you go all the way to pay for the carbon fiber by needing fewer batteries, you also cut out 80% of the capital and all the hard steps in making the car. So the ultralighting turns out then to be approximately free, and you can get cars off oil for $18 a barrel. So this represents, in U.S. auto potential, one and a half Saudis or half an OPEC at $18 a barrel. And if your oil business hurts at $90 and swoons at $50, how does it do at 18 and falling? Probably not very well, which is why oil companies' big problem is not falling price, it's vanishing demand. In other words, platform fitness enables electrification, batteries, fuel cells, whatever, much cheaper, much sooner, and then autonomy accelerates that further. But notice that when you're using light, strong materials, you've decoupled size from weight. You were, I think, tacitly equating the two and assuming efficient cars have to be small. But in fact, when they're made of materials like this, they can be big, which is comfortable, and protective. Protection comes from crush length, not from weight. But they don't have to be heavy, which is hostile and inefficient. So you can end up saving lives, oil, and money simultaneously. And that's why we and others were able to get NHTSA to change the rules some years back. So efficiency rules were enforced based on size, not weight. Because the weight way of doing it was leading us to this nutty mass arms race where, you know, you drive an SUV and he drives an 18-wheeler and she drives a locomotive. This is nuts, but it's where we were headed. And now that the rules are different, there's an incentive to make cars whatever size people want, but light and efficient. That's a nice example of enlightened regulation by a simple administrative tweak.
Yeah, the CAFE standards had a fair number of issues in them of that sort.
We're going to beat CAFE by a factor 2 to 4 based on demand pull, not regulation. The CAFE will be there to prevent recidivism, but people are going to buy cars in the 1 or 2 liter per 100 kilometer range, not 6 or 8, because they're better, not because they're efficient.
So I sort of can't resist the prop. When do you think we see cars built from those kinds of materials being the norm rather than the exception?
There's between 4 and 7 automakers that have now adopted our strategy, and DOE did 2 years ago. It took 10 years to convince them. Because what they were assuming in industry and government was, electric cars are nice. They have a lot of advantages if you do them right. So let's do a lot of R&D to try to make batteries cheap enough that people will buy those cars so we can make a bunch and they'll get cheap. And I was saying, well, wait a minute. Why don't we have fewer batteries to start with by making the car light and slippery? And that's equivalent to having cheaper batteries. And then you can sell a bunch. And then with the volume, they get cheaper. So you get to your destination, but with a lot less time, cost, and risk. And that is now starting to happen. So I think it's been clear for 5 years that lightweighting and electrification are the hottest strategic trends in the industry, and now add shareability and autonomy, and things move into fast forward real fast. So I think over the next 15 years, this industry is going to change beyond recognition.
If you think about the world, and since 2050 is the date you picked, more sort of day in the life kind of thing, right? What does the car look like? What does the apartment look like? What does the building look like? Right, what has changed?
Building looks like a building, whatever you want. It doesn't need any heating or cooling because it's passive. It produces more electricity than it uses on the building or nearby, usually just part of the fabric of the building. You don't even notice it. This is, by the way, already rather common, particularly in Europe, but it's already built into the design targets of everybody from the European Union, the state of California, to the Army Corps of Engineers. It's a pretty commonplace. All the professional associations are lined up with it over the next 5 to 15 years. You probably get around less because you don't need to so much, because where you live, play, shop, and work are both integrated and distributed, so you don't need to travel far, you don't need to travel by car. And you then are in the world that the Gen X, Gen Y folks are in right now, where very few want to own a car because it's cheaper and easier not to. And that's because we have, of course, it'll be quite advanced by then, what are now smartphone apps that know where you are and can summon ubiquitous transport services on demand and integrated with all the existing public and private modes. And you'll also do a lot of virtual mobility, just moving the electrons, leaving the heavy nuclei at home. Your appliances will be very efficient. They'll work better than they do now. They'll be cheaper. That's just the way the markets develop. You'll be working more flexibly at home and wherever you are. As now, communications will be ubiquitous, only more so. You'll have virtual presence in your hand. That's Moore's Law. It'll just be like now, only better, as long as we deal with a whole bunch of issues along the way, like the extreme vulnerability of the electric grid to disruption, which could put us back in the 7th century irrecoverably, by cyber attack, physical attack, EMP, earthquakes, cyberstorms, superstorms, and a lot of other stuff. I hope we will have designed that out and gone to a more diverse, distributed, renewable, highly resilient system where major failures are impossible by design.
Here, I'm trying to end on the Jetsons and you're going to the rise of the machines.
Yeah, but I hope we'll also be better human beings because we might have had more chance to focus on what's worth doing. That's not a question for energy policy, but it's a really important one.
Amory, I'd like to thank you for a wonderful hour.